There is a group of us across the industry working on developing best practices, and I'm going to tell you a little bit about it. I apologize to some of you. Some of you have seen some of these slides before, but we've made a lot of progress since the last time I talked about this subject, so most of them are new. But about 10 years ago, when we really started seeing heavy use of supplemental materials, we really were seeing two worlds colliding. All of a sudden, technology enabled us to do things we never could do before, so we wanted to do them, but we still were very firmly planted in a print world. At the same time, you were seeing an explosion of research. I've been told there are more researchers alive today than there have ever been in the history of the world. So you have more data, you have more accrued knowledge. Also, we were starting to see in the early years of the last decade, increased requirements. NIH came out with the requirements for posting data. We now have the NSF data stewardship plan. And many disciplines have been developing reporting standards. In psychology, it's JARS, the Journal Article Reporting Standards. So you have all these pressures on publishers. So supplemental materials sounded like a great idea. We could allow the author to expand on their research. And if you look at supplemental materials, an awful lot of it is what the editor said, no, there's not space for that in this article. Science, we thought, would be much better because the data needed to verify or replicate the study could be provided at very little additional cost, we thought. We could enhance the reporting of science with multimedia. So we looked at technology to solve our problems, but we still kept those very print-centric views. And each of us did it on our own. Maybe we looked at what somebody else was doing, but there were no standards or best practices. So the outcomes for the author, they're probably pretty good. They got to showcase work that might otherwise not have been seen. But they also risk displaying really weak work that otherwise might not be seen. We're all familiar with finding this table, this orphan table. Who knows what it was related to? If you're lucky, you've got a link back to the article, but you have no context. You have a bibliography. What does it mean? And so forth. For the users, and Sasha Schwartzman talks about abuse, and there is abuse. I mean, it's lack. You don't have metadata. There are discoverability issues. You may hear about something, it's hard to find. At APA, we put our supplemental material on the open web. Some of it you can find, some of it you can't. The lack of context is something that has really bugged me. And there's concern about persistence. Most of us are not tagging our materials. The archives will take your supplemental material if you're putting it in, but there are no rules for that. There's no clarity on how you cite this material. And there's often some mystery in the main article about whether this is supplemental or I really need to read this to understand the work. So it may not be a value add. And then there are the outcomes for the publisher. First of all, there are a lot of direct costs. Every time my folks post another file, I'm spending money. Every time my customer relations people have to respond to a question, I'm spending money. And then there are diverted energies. I agree, Anthony, peer review is not broken, but there is clearly some sort of crisis. When at STM meeting, we heard somebody from APS say that they were considering financial incentives to get peer reviewers. If a faculty member would act as a peer review, the library could get a discount on the subscription. When neuroscience stopped doing supplemental materials, the stated reason was the stress on the peer review system. So you have some really tough decisions. What is value add? This dilemma about we say we peer review it, but are we really peer reviewing it? And what kind of plans should we make for migration? So a group of us came together last year. Todd Carpenter proposed to Bonnie Lawler that there be a NISO NFACE working group. It was prompted. Sasha Schwartzman at AGU had written a paper describing responses to a survey he sent out as he puzzled over what AGU should be doing. I think we have a very good mix of people across the industry. There are several in the audience. Dave Martinson and Sasha Schwartzman are both here, and I saw Annette Flanagan from JAMA at the back. There are really two working groups. Marie McVeigh from Thomson Reuters is co-chairing the business working group with me, and we're looking at defining supplemental materials, as Anthony said, defining related terms. You know, you get yourself in this mess and you think, well, what is an article? Recommending methods of referencing and linking to and from, recommendations around persistent identifiers, what should be peer reviewed, how do you produce it, curate it. And then there are issues around if you if you ask your authors to transfer copyright on those supplemental materials, then you've got a permissions management issue. Each of us has responsibilities in this. The technical working group, Dave and Sasha are co-chairing this, and they're looking at the technical aspects of it, recommending supports, recommending processes for archiving, the packaging, the exchange, what kind of technical support is required for accessibility. It's really remarkable when you pull a group like this together because you realize that we are so different across scholarly publishing. Disciplines vary in their use of supplemental material. There are different cultures. There are different citation systems. And our readers in all of these areas vary in their need for information. Some people are just looking for current awareness. Some people are really doing some deep digging. Some people are wanting to replicate the study. We have different approaches across publishers to the underlying data. Some require that it be posted in a publicly accessible place. Some people require that it be posted with a journal. Some people don't have anything to say about it. We also have very different approaches to delivery systems. Many publishers are delivering their content themselves on their own platform. APA has our full text content on 8 different platforms. So we're technology enabled, but we are still using print. So data is one type of supplemental material, and it is a true example of this evolving ecosystem. In the print world, data sets were not even considered as part of an article. For some, meant that data was really synonymous with supplemental material. But today, we're seeing journal articles and even whole journals devoted to publishing data. And for those, certainly, these are essential parts of the article. Management of data in general is not within the scope of the practices that we're going to be recommending. But we will address the inclusion of data when it's published as supplemental. And we have a little aside on sharing. I mentioned this, you know, some people require posting, some don't. APA has we really came up against this recently. We realized that our ethics code requires only that authors share data to researchers for verification. So if Bill thinks I was wrong, then I need to give him my data so that he can prove I'm wrong. It's a pretty negative approach, and we're going to be changing that. So there is the ideal and the reality. Anthony mentioned Efke's study. 84% of the scientists think it's useful to link data to articles, but only 25% said their data are publicly available. In psychology, we hear 80% of psychologists say they share their data. But then you start asking people if they've ever successfully gotten anybody's data, it's not such a great number. And then there's the example of the Harvard faculty. There are lots of reasons for not sharing. It takes time. It may require extensive explanations of your coding scheme. Or maybe you just need to clean it up before anybody else could look at it. I'm not finished. I can get more articles. I don't want you using my data. Who will protect it? Will I be created? So there are lots and lots of fears, and anybody who works with human subject participants has some additional concerns. You hear psychologists a lot say, you know, I'm doing research to help this population, and this data could be turned around and used against them. So what we're saying is collaborative sharing is a best practice that requires clear metadata and explanations, that there are professional ethics to be considered around secondary analysis. And one of the big questions is, what about authorship for the person who collected all of that research data? And then they're particularly concerned for studies with human participants. Multimedia is another example. 5 years ago, audio or video was not generally possible in the article. And today it is still primarily supplemental material. But people are now incorporating it into PDFs. Pretty soon will we see executables as part of an article. I do think that, as Anthony said, we're going to have much more interactive content. So what is supplemental today probably is not tomorrow. And we were particularly struck. We had a conversation with Emily Marcus, who's the editor-in-chief of Cell, with her statement in the editorial when Cell went to a different way of handling data. Over time, the concept of supplemental material will gradually give way to a more modern concept of a hierarchical or layered presentation where the reader chooses. So we really believe that the article tomorrow may be linked chunks or the distributed model that Dave was talking about yesterday. So we have real challenges as publishers. We have these expectations. You know, we firmly believe that quality is the key thing here. So we say we're going to peer review everything. We're going to edit to the same level as the article. We'll maintain all those links. We'll assure that we migrate the content. But there are truly limiting factors. People resources, of course, financial resources, and technical resources. Not so much is the technology going to make me able to do it, but do I have the technical resources? So we think we need some order now. So what we've defined in this group after, and we started meeting last August, and I think our minutes said, or the last meeting said that we had had our 21st meeting. We looked at three kinds of content. The integral, this is critical to understanding the work that is reported, but for some technical reason it cannot be presented within the framework of the article. This one we are quite certain will go away, maybe not in too distant a future. Then there's the additional content, the layered stuff that Emily was talking about. It's the expansion of the core article. It's added detail. It's context. It may have the data you need to replicate the study. It may be, I have seen entire articles on the methodology that was used as a supplement. Other related is a real mixed bag because it's handled so differently in so many different publishers. It's content that will add to the understanding or enable replication. It's usually hosted somewhere else, and neither the publisher or maybe even the author has no control over it. So we've looked at practices for selecting content, editing content, assuring findability, and citing it for the first part. And what we are saying is that you should review at some level. And it needs to be useful and relevant, not simply serve as a file drawer for everything that the author thought about saying and the editor did not choose to put it in. Editing, you know, it would be wonderful if everything was edited at the same level of the article. But what we're saying is if it's not, then it should carry a notice that it was not. And many of us are doing that today. We say this content is as the author provided it. Findability is a big issue. There is no consistency right now in how people are telling you that there is supplemental material. And very few abstracting and indexing services are covering supplemental material, noting the fact that it exists, partly because people can't find it easily, and partly because some of them probably haven't added the field. But I know we include it in PsycInfo, and I'm sure we don't pick it all up. There needs to be in the online table of contents a note that there are supplemental materials. You don't want to hide it. If you're going to go to this effort, you want people to find it. What we're saying about citing is within the article you should cite and link just as you would for any other table or figure. But if it is integral to the content, it should not be included in the reference list. We've also been looking at providing links and context, preservation, assuring accessibility, rights management. Links, they should be bi-directional if possible, and Efke Schmidt is on our group, and she was the one who convinced us that repositories are now at a point where they can do bi-directional linking. Preservation at integral, you've got to think about the same level as the article, and you need to be clear on what you can do. And again, this was Efke's recommendation to us, that you encourage authors to deposit their content somewhere else. Redundancy it can be very good. Accessibility is a very ticklish issue. It should be at the same level as the article. What we're saying is you should strive for the ideal, but we do recognize the difficulty. Rights management, you should treat rights the same way as you do for the article and recognize you have no authority over other related content. So we have these two groups. The business working group is looking at what? The technical working group is looking at how you can do it. They have the more difficult task. They have formed 5 working group task forces. They are looking at metadata. They have a straw man DTD. They're looking at linking and persistent identifiers, packaging and an exchange, preservation and archiving, and accessibility. And Chuck Kosher is in the room as well. He's a member of the technical working group and chairing at least one of those groups. Our next step, we think we'll be ready early this summer to start sharing the draft recommended practices. The technical working group is going to have their subgroups meeting over the summer. Fall, we're going to start to see if we can meld and refine this. It goes to NISO and NFACE for approval. It gets shared with the community and refined. This is only going to be a temporary roadmap. It should be a living document for a rapidly changing environment. So we welcome ideas. There is a business stakeholders group that you can sign up for to be notified of when you can look at things. And I realized in talking to Anthony today that we probably need to talk to NISO about getting more things visible on that site now. Now we have something that we could perhaps share. Thank you.